Welcome. Welcome this afternoon. Welcome to our Enlightened Entrepreneurship series. Thank you so much for gathering together here on your Friday afternoon. And my name is Julie Sampson. I'm the director of the Scheinfeld Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation here at Santa Barbara City College.
Thanks.
We have a wonderful event planned here for you today that promises to inspire you on your entrepreneurial journey. This event is hosted by the Scheinfeld Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation and the Small Business Development Center. So let me just see, how many of you, raise your hand if you have heard of the Scheinfeld Center? Oh, okay, excellent. There's getting to be more and more people raising their hands, and we like that. But for those of you who didn't raise your hand, and even for those of you who did, we might offer some things that you are unaware of, so I just want to go over some of our offerings so that we're all on the same page, because we have offerings that can support all of you in your endeavors as an entrepreneur and small business owner. So let's take a look. Okay, so at the Scheinfeld Center, we are all about helping entrepreneurs shine. Whether you want to start or grow a business or apply entrepreneurial skills within your job, we've got you covered. We help you do this through academics, hands-on learning, and business support. At the core of our Scheinfeld Center is our academic program that enables you to build your business in the classroom and earn a degree at the same time. Whether you want to shore up a gap in your entrepreneurial skills, or you want to start a business or grow an existing business, our classes can help you carry that out in the classroom. So we encourage you, if you haven't already, to explore our academic program in entrepreneurship. But entrepreneurship is about doing, and so we complement this academic program with events, hands-on experience, and resources that assist you in your entrepreneurial development. This event, this Enlightened Entrepreneurship Series, is one of those. What's so awesome about this is it allows you, in an intimate setting like this, to hear about how a distinguished entrepreneur has made it in their own journey and allows you one-on-one interaction with that entrepreneur. Another important offering that we have is our Enterprise Launch Program, in which students launch a product or service in a single semester. We have amazing participation from our students, and some of them are here today. Raise your hand if you have been in Enterprise Launch or are currently in. Go ahead. Yep. Okay, great. With all of this competition or kindling the entrepreneurial spirit, it brings up a lot of good competition among students. And so because of this, every year we host our new Venture Challenge Business Plan and Pitch Competition that's open to college and high school students alike throughout our region. Mark your calendar. The 6th annual New Venture Challenge will be coming up in April 2016. 2016, can you believe it? Almost around the corner. One of the greatest challenges that students have is bridging the gap between academics and actually working. So we help solve this challenge through our internship program. The Scheinfeld Center internship program provides opportunities for students enrolled in any discipline to undertake an internship focused on local and international business and entrepreneurship opportunities. We advocate for paid internships, and we advocate for real life experiences that benefit both the business and the intern alike. We continuously maintain a great pool of interns and internship sponsors, and we encourage you to explore our program further. Come and see us at the reception. Finally, wrapped around everything we do is our Small Business Development Center, which is a community, state, and federally funded organization that provides no-cost business coaching and counseling to the business community and students alike. We are also a center for international trade development that helps businesses expand internationally. It's important for you to know about these resources and that they're available to everyone in this room and within our community. For businesses that need assistance with startup, financing, creating and retaining jobs, increasing sales, and expanding internationally, we can help you with that. Of course, none of this would be possible without the generosity of the late Jim Scheinfeld and his wife, Elna Scheinfeld, who provided an endowment on which the Scheinfeld Center was started. This is Jim Scheinfeld at work in his day. And we are really fortunate to have Elna Scheinfeld with us here in the audience, here in the front row. Elna, let's give her a hand. Thank you, Elna, for being here. And now, without further ado, I would like to welcome our moderator this afternoon. Does anybody know business administration faculty member, Dean of Business Programs, and founding director of the Scheinfeld Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, Melissa Moreno? Melissa continues to be a strong supporter and advocate of the Scheinfeld Center, and we appreciate so much your participation here today. Thanks, Melissa. And now, with great pleasure, I would like to introduce to you our distinguished entrepreneur this afternoon, who is recognized as one of the pioneers of something we can all relate to, pre-washed jeans. Gene Montesano is well known as the co-founder of Lucky Brand Jeans, and also the founder of four distinguished and successful restaurants in town, including Joe's Cafe, Trey Loon, Bucatini, and D'Angelo's Bakery. But that's not all. He is founder of Civilianaire Clothing and also a boutique for men and women in Montecito carrying this clothing. He also recently launched a gelato company called Black Market Gelato. It's so good, it's hard to believe it's legal. You might wonder, so why restaurants and clothing? Well, Gene refers to himself as a frustrated innkeeper in search of quality in the basics of life, like clothing, food, and shelter. Let's hear more about his entrepreneurial adventure. Please give Gene Montesano a warm introduction.
First, let me start by sincerely welcoming you to the Scheinfeld Center and thanking you for sharing this time with us. This is a precious gift to us today, so thank you very much for being here. So the format for today is that I have a series of questions to start the conversation, and we'll go about 30 or 40 minutes, and then I'm going to open it up to the audience to have interaction with the audience. We have two mics, one on either side of the stage, and so we're really encouraging our students and our community to come up, and hopefully I'll notice you there, and we can stop what we're doing and entertain your questions. So this is an opportunity for everybody here in the audience today. So are you ready to begin?
I think I am.
We have heard so many stories of successful entrepreneurs who started with no funding, which is really very inspiring to our students, given how difficult it is to get startup funding. You may not have had any money to speak of when you opened your first shop, but you had something else. You had connections. Can you take us back to your times in Florida with your buddy Barry Perlman? How old were you, and how were you able to open up a shop without any funding?
Well, we had plenty of ideas and some drive, and I think I was 22 or 23. And I got together with Barry, and I was making the custom leather goods and applique stuff, and they were working in a boutique, and I came back to town, and I was going to open up a leather store. How, I don't know, because I didn't have any money, but I had a little bit of leather. And Barry was working in a clothing store. They were going to open up a clothing store. So we got together, and we opened up, and I did all the leather work, and they sold the clothes, and we didn't have any money. We had a couple of $100, but back, this is like 1974, you didn't need a whole lot of money. You needed some 2x4s, and so we built the store by hand and did everything but lay the carpet. And Barry's uncle had a business in Texas called Al's Formal Wear, and he let us use his credit line for the first few months. But jeans were retail, $6. So it wasn't like you needed a lot of money. A jean now could be for anywhere from $50 to $300. So we didn't need that much, and we got going, and stuff we bought sold, and eventually we got terms on our own, and that's how we kind of did it, with very little funding.
So I heard you spent some time in the laundromat with Barry. Can you talk about what that was like, what you were doing?
Well, you know, we were buying jeans, and, you know, we'd buy, you know, 60 pieces, and we'd go to the laundromat. A buddy of ours' father owned some laundromats. So we'd go with a bag of quarters and a few gallons of bleach and put some in, a gallon in that one and a half a gallon in this one and none in the other one, and throw the quarters in and wash the jeans. And we were like the only guys that had pre-washed jeans and all these different colors. So it was kind of innovative, and it enabled us to have something that nobody else had. So that was kind of the beginning of that.
So you're the inventor of pre-washed vintage jeans.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big statement, but I'll take a little credit for it. At least in South Miami we were.
Yeah. So what's the importance of connections? Do you still value having connections today, and can any entrepreneur survive without having connections in the right places?
Well, you know, I mean, it's in how you do business. And if you do business and you're honest about it, and you try to do it in the right way, you'll accumulate people and connections, and it's all in the way you treat them. And you know, when you can help, you do, and they help you, and it becomes like a whole, you know. It's, I mean, that's kind of what we've always done. We always, you know, when I first started this company, Bongo Jeans, in the 80s, we had this, we did this mini skirt that had these two big zippers, and they were like a dollar a piece, and we didn't have any credit, but the guy that believed in us said, listen, I'll give you guys credit, and for 35 years, I don't think I ever bought another zipper or button or anything from anybody but him. So, you know, when you do business that way, you have this network of people that are willing to take a bullet for you. You know, and then you do the same thing for people, and it just keeps it going, you know?
Right. Thank you. So at the Scheinfeld Center, our students study the entrepreneurial mindset. What do you think makes for a successful entrepreneur?
Well, you know, you have to love your idea and believe in it. And if you're lucky to find somebody that's like-minded, that believes, you know, that can help you, it's, you know, that's great. And then you have to have a conscience about it, you know, like I said before, about treating everybody right along the way and getting people to want you to win. And it's amazing that, you know, when you do that and people see it, how everybody's willing to help you out. I don't know, did that answer the question?
Yeah, it does. But I'm also curious about your intrinsic talent that you have that leads to you being a successful entrepreneur. Does every entrepreneur need some intrinsic talent?
Well, you know, I've always looked at things and I just kind of, like, you know, unfortunately or fortunately, I always find what's wrong with something and want to make it better. So that's how this happened. And, you know, in school I wasn't a great student, and you know, so it came time to graduate high school. And I said goodbye to one of my teachers. I mean, I took like home ec, you know, because, you know, I wasn't a great student. So anything where I could get a C or a D, I was pretty happy. So when I went to say goodbye to my home ec teacher, she said, well, you're not going anywhere. I said, well, I'm a senior, so I'm graduating. She said, well, no, you're not, because I'm going to fail you, because you drove the field trips, you did all of this stuff. So she said, you see that couch over there? And I said, yeah. She said, well, I want you to, you have to upholster that couch if you want to graduate. Wow. So I'm looking at this thing, and I'm very right brain, no left brain hardly at all, except for balance. And I looked at it, and I figured, I'm going to get some newspaper, I'm going to trace the piece, I'm going to put the allowance for the seams, and I made these fantastic covers for this couch. It was, like, perfect. And I guess, you know, it stuck with me, and it taught me how to do all of this stuff, you know. It was rattling around in there, so, you know, that's kind of how that happened.
Did you graduate?
I did. Good. I did. I had to charm my English teacher, and she gave me a C on my term paper, and that's what really did it, but I wasn't going anywhere unless I did that.
Thank you. So I mentioned that when we met for coffee, that the founder of Patagonia was here before you, and Yvon Chouinard. And he came up on the stage and told us that education is overrated. Given that you had difficulty in high school, how do you feel about education for entrepreneurs?
Listen, I think it's important, I think what we were learning in 1968 was very different than what you guys have the opportunity to learn now. I think education is important. I didn't have like a business acumen that was, it was like the abacus. I knew if I made it for two and sold it for five and I did everything else right, that I had a shot. I think education is very important, especially, something like this that you're able to do.
After you finished in Florida, you went on to work for Guess. Can you tell us about that experience?
Well, I came out to California, and I borrowed like a couple hundred dollars from a friend of mine. We drove out together. I stayed. He went back. And I got a job working for this jean company, and he was paying me $200 a week. And, and I was making him kind of successful, and I wasn't making anything. And so another guy said, hey, help me out, and when I make it, you make it. So I helped him out, and we were making it, and he bought a condominium and a Porsche, and I got a bicycle. So I said, well, this isn't working for me, so I'm going to leave. And he said, well, make a list of what you want to stay. And I said, well, why don't you make a list of what you want to give me to stay? So I left, and I got another job, and I worked for the Marciano brothers at Guess Jeans. And that's what really showed me that hard work definitely pays off. And because these guys, they came here, they had some money, they had success in France, and they came here, and you never saw anybody, no matter what time you got there, they were there, and no matter when you left, they were still there. And, that was a real fast horse to be on. So that was a great learning experience. And then I went to them, and I said, look, this is great and everything. I was kind of like the fifth brother. Because it was a small company, it was a couple of million dollar company, but I really wanted to be in business for myself. So I went to them and I said, look, I'm going to leave and I want to be in business for myself. And I started Bongo Jeans, and that was really the thing that just kind of propelled me. I didn't have any money, and I knew this cat, Michael Caruso, and he was a good seller and had some money and went to University of Texas Business School. So I saw this could be interesting. So I asked him for a ride to work, and he picked me up, and I put the idea of Bongo Jeans in his head, and he called me a week later and said, let's try it. So we tried it, and it just took off, and the rest is history.
So he was the business mind, and you were the creative person in that partnership?
Yeah.
And for those of us in the audience, or those of you in the audience that aren't old enough to remember Bongo Jeans, I remember Bongo Jeans. They were most popular jeans in the early 80s.
Yeah, it was,
right?
it was
very,
it was
successful.
Pretty big.
So what brought you and your buddy Barry Perlman together again after Bongo?
Well, we remained good friends, and I would always say, you got to come out here because this is, everything was being made in Los Angeles. You could do anything. You could make pants, shirts, dye things. It was incredible. It was like, so I said, well, come out. We'll start a men's shirt company. We'll start a kids company or something. Just come out. So he came out, and we started. I really started Lucky Brand, and I brought Barry in and made him a partner, and I went to my partner Michael at Bongo, and I said, look, you know, I really want to make great stuff, and we're making good stuff, but I want to put a rivet, I want to put a nicer label, I want to make it as best as I can. And I said, so I'm going to make them twice the price in the opposite gender. So if you want to do it with me, terrific, we can be partners. If not, I'm going to do it myself, and if Bongo should start to suffer, you know, well, then we have something to talk about. But I don't think it will, because it's going to be men's, they were women's, and the jeans are going to be 60, not 29, so I went and did it, and it worked.
So you had to be careful because you were leaving Bongo, which was women's jeans, and you couldn't compete with Bongo. So that's
right.
What you're referring to. Yeah.
Right.
And so you started Lucky Brand as a primarily a man's jean.
Totally men's for the first 2 years. And then I felt okay about making women's jeans because they were still twice the price. It was a completely different business. And I took a building that was right next door, so I had a little thing in the fence I could just walk back and forth all day. So it was great. And I would show people like Bongo as the shining star, and then all of a sudden, you know, Lucky became the shining star because it was really, it really took off pretty quick.
So describe a little bit about the Lucky Brand Jeans Company. You were designing your own stuff. Were you also doing your own manufacturing? So you were the whole kit and caboodle for the company?
Well, I did all the design for the first few years, and everything is contracted out. So we didn't have machines or anything, but you know, we'd buy the fabric and design the stuff and make the patterns, and then a cutter would cut it, deliver it to the contractors, that we'd get it, do the washes that we were going to do on it, and ship it. And that's kind of how that works.
So it's my sense that you value Made in America, and that it seems like all of your brands are made in America, but there's so much opportunity for manufacturing and distribution internationally. So what is your perspective on global manufacturing, global trade?
Well, every time I start something, of course, it starts made in America, because I think that's what we should be doing. But, you know, the retailers want price, and you just can't compete. You just can't do it in America. We used to sew jeans for $3. Now that same jean would be $11 to sew it. And you got minimum wage going up, and it makes it impossible. And really, American manufacturing has really become like, no, we can't, we won't. That's why all American mills are gone, because their numbers have to be so high. If you wanted to buy some as 10,000 yards of a color instead of 1,000 yards and be able to put people in business, because the minimums were small. Everything was geared to Levi or Wrangler or Lee, so it was very difficult. And now it's like impossible. You got to buy piece goods from wherever you can. And we're still sewing here, but you know, for the first 10 years, we made everything at Bongo in America, and then most of it went offshore. So there are very few factories left, and it's kind of a shame.
Mm-hmm. At what point did you realize that the brand was going to be successful?
Pretty quick. You know, I started and I made a couple hundred pair of jeans, and I just gave them away to people. And everybody said, these are so comfortable. And you could, like, drive, and if you got to a toll booth, you could just reach your hands in the pockets. You didn't have to do all of that. And it was just, and I just heard from everybody that when they, you know, they usually come home from work, they put on their sweats and they go about their life. And people were just saying, you know, I come home, I don't even take them off. So I knew I had something. And then we placed it pretty good, you know, Nordstrom and everything. But when they put the Lucky You in the Fly thing, that was really a great one. That was a great branding marketing thing. You can imagine the stories I heard about it. And that was when, you know, the whole Clarence Thomas thing was going on. So I came up with that, and people said, well, what are you going to do with that? I said, well, I'm going to put it in the Fly. And he said, no, you can't do that. And I said, yeah, you can do that. And we did it, and it was really a great one. And when we were getting ready to, and then we, you know, Lucky You and Too Tough to Die and all that stuff. So people would get in horrific accidents, and we'd get a letter that they live because of their Lucky T-shirt or the Lucky You and the Fly or Too Tough to Die. Mm. And just one more second, we were selling the business to Liz Claiborne. So I get a phone call, we're in this meeting with them, and I get a phone call from a friend. He says, you gotta turn on, you know, CNN. And I turn it on, and this girl was at a railroad crossing in Indiana and got rear-ended. And she gets rear-ended into a train. The train takes her half a mile down the road, and she's dialing 911 on her cell phone, her mother and everything, and she gets out, and they're interviewing her, and she says, I attribute being alive to my Lucky Brand t-shirt and my faith in God as as we're doing this deal. So they just, I mean, it really set the hook. They had to. They had to buy it. But that was really a good one.
Do you believe in luck?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But I also believe that you make some, you know, you make some of your own luck. But I definitely believe in luck.
Thank you. Great story.
Thank you.
When we met earlier, you mentioned you didn't do much formal business planning. So I'm wondering, how did you survive or flourish without a business plan?
Like I said before, you know, it's like the abacus. I knew that if I, you know, if I could make it and I knew what my cost was and I knew I could sell it for X, that watching the rest of it would kind of take care of itself. And I still think it's kind of that easy. But that's in manufacturing a product. You know, everything else is very different, I guess. And the restaurant business is, you know, I've been successful in it, and sometimes I just don't know how, because I really didn't put a lot of, like, thought into it. Other than I knew what I wanted it to be. I was crystal clear on that, how to do that, and how I wanted it to be when you got there, and how I wanted to treat people, and what I wanted it to be. But the rest of it, if I thought about things like food cost and this and front of the house and back of the house and this and systems, I would have no restaurants, probably.
Interesting.
But so, I would still do another one. Yeah. Knowing all that now. That's the luck part, I guess.
Well, Paul Orfila told us that his disability, ADHD, and he really does have an inability to read or write. It was a gift because it forced him to see the value in teaming up with others around you that have strengths where you're weak. And his point was that it's impossible to be successful alone. So how important is your team to you, especially given that you don't do much planning?
Well, yeah, I have the same problem that Paul has. I've really never really read a book, and if I read a paragraph, I get to the bottom of it and I got to go back to the top to see what I just read 30 times. So I just kind of gave up. So, you know, I can relate to that. But whenever I did it with somebody, I mostly did it for the company. You know, the company of having some of the camaraderie of looking over and saying, hey, we're doing it, isn't this great? And, you know, but with Bongo, I had, you know, he was completely left brain and I'm completely right brain. So that really worked. Barry and I are more both right brain. But, you know, Paul's business is very different than mine. You know, I can make this thing that can turn somebody on and they're going to go buy it, you know, or make something that tastes great and it feels good to be there and people are going to react to it. You know, I mean, Kinko's is a very different business. I mean, if you want to buy loose leaf paper, you can get it anywhere. So it's kind of a different business, you know?
Right. So really, it's for you, it's the creative part. You talked about the packaging.
And everything, all of that stuff. You know, if you go to Joe's, I just put a shot glass on the walls with all the locals and a brass thing underneath the shot glass. You know, that's not about me, that's about you all and our appreciation for you being, you know, a loyal customer and stuff. And, you know, Trey Luna, we did a wooden chair with your name on a little brass thing. And that's, you know, I mean, people, you know, they want to know that you care, and we do care. I mean, I definitely do care about every little detail. And people can relate to it, and they want to come back. And you know, you open a restaurant, you take this box, and you go in there. And if you had time lapse photography, you know, you see a bunch of contractors going in and drywall going in, and then all of a sudden they're coming out, and people going in two and three times, you know, a week or five to whatever the number is, and you create this thing, this habit for people that they want to go there, you know, and they want to start their day off with a coffee or finish it with a drink or having dinner, and it's such an incredible thing to do. So, I mean, I love it.
That's great.
I don't know if that answered the question because
it did. Thank you.
Okay, good.
Is there any one person in your life that mentored you or provided entrepreneurial inspiration to you?
Whew. Maybe Ilio Fiorucci. He was a great merchant, and he just passed away recently, at, I don't know, well into his 80s, and he always remained a child. And he really started a huge fashion thing in the 70s and went on till all the way to now. And he was an incredible guy and just a kind and gentle guy and really still a child. I saw him at a show and he looked at every little booth and every little wind-up toy from Japan and he was like so into every detail. And he had a store in Milan that was crazy. It was three stories on Piazza di Babila. And he started with all the guys, Replay, Diesel, all of those guys, all were kind of inspired by him and me included. So I guess probably him.
Today, you have your hands in the restaurant business and again in a brand of jeans. Why did you transition into the restaurant business when your expertise was in retail, and I'm very curious how your retail talent transfers to the restaurant business.
I got into the restaurant business because I was redoing a house in Los Angeles, and I had no kitchen for a while. And I was traveling to Europe a lot in the 80s, and I was going to Italy mostly. And the food was incredible. And when I came back, my partner Barry had just moved out here, and he took me to this restaurant that opened up in a neighborhood called Farfalla. And I went in there, and the place was the size of this chair. I mean, it must have sat maybe eight people or something, but the food was incredible. And I was starting to make some money, so I said, listen, Giancarlo, if you want to open up, you know, another restaurant, I'll put up the money. So we opened up a few. We opened up in Aspen in Miami and one on La Brea in L.A., and I did that for a while, and I just liked it. I liked being an owner of a restaurant. I love food. And then I got out of that business with them, and I moved up here. And I bumped into one of our chefs was working at, I think, Panivino, Dario. And I said, hey, I'm moving up here, and I might like to do another restaurant. So we opened up Bucatini, and then shortly after, we opened up Cadario. And then I just liked it. And I didn't want to go to the same restaurant for the same food every night, so I liked having my own. Of course, I could have it exactly the way I liked it. No, it's the truth. And then, you know, I wanted a place where I could go for breakfast where the coffee was the way I liked it, because I think most coffee is like just weak and I like real coffee. So I bought D'Angelo and made that what I wanted it to be. I mean, I liked it before, but I think it could be better, and I think I made it better. And it reminded me of New York and sitting outside, and you know, there was always like a bohemian crowd, which I kind of liked. And then, you know, I would go there in the morning, someone would be sitting next to me and they'd say hi, and then the next day they'd hand me an envelope, wanted me to back them in something. So I stopped going to D'Angelo and I opened up Tre Lune in Montecito. And that was a place I went to, but they made me crazy because it was so complicated just to have a coffee. So I started doing breakfast at Tre Lune. And you know, for a year I almost bled to death because two people, then six people, then eight people. Now you can do 100 customers. So it's another thing about the business that you have to be able to have some staying power or the will to do it when it's not working. So that's how I kind of got into it. I wanted to have a place where I could go for a steak. So I thought, you know, I did Lucky's. And you know, and it would be a place where we could go that was kind of rat packy, you know, where all of our friends could hang out, but go for a really nice dinner and a good steak. So we did that, and that took off, and it worked, and it's still going great. And, you know, so I like the restaurant business.
Do you pay attention to setting a culture in a company?
Culture?
Yeah, like...
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So tell us about what your values are as a business owner.
Well, you know, we touched on it before, treating everybody right and just, you know, and having a nice culture. And we've always had great cultures at all the companies. Somebody came over to me today that worked for me a long time ago and said, hey, you know, it was great working for you back then. I had to leave early, but I wanted to come and say hello. And we, you know, we just get that all the time. It was always for either Barry or I's birthday, we had a big barbecue in the parking lot. And it was never about just doing business. It was about, you know, having a family. And even at Civilianaire, we have this, I always put in a really cool, like, you know, almost catering kitchen in my businesses. And we'll make pasta and this, and I'll make sausage and peppers during the week. And we have like a feast. There's like 12 of us sit down at a big, long table. So, you know, that's and it's a family. Where, you know, you spend more time, you know, at work than you do at home. So it was always about having a culture and treating people right. And it was, so we were really good at building a culture.
So I want to take you back to your days at Lucky. And, you know, we tell students that the longer you hold on to a business, the bigger the risk it is for failure. Mm-hmm. Did you ever have any moments in that 10-year period that you thought that Lucky was going to go downhill? Did you have any bad moments that you want to share?
You know, mostly we just wanted to make it right. So we got to the point, we were probably a $60 million business and had 8 stores. And I said, you know, look, we're going to get to the point where we don't know everything, and we need to find a strategic partner. So a buddy of ours made an appointment with the people, Liz Claiborne. They were very interested in buying us. And so they did, and it was we made a nice hit. And then we had a 5-year contract. So we stayed for that, and I stayed for another 5. I stayed 10 years after I sold the business, which was probably pretty crazy. The first 5 were great, and then they brought in a new guy. And the great thing about doing that deal is that Paul Sharon was the CEO, and he said, I need you guys to be our cowboys on the West Coast, so when we push, you push back. So we always pushed back. Then the culture changed there, and the new people didn't believe in founders, and they didn't believe in this. And then when 2008 happened, the world crashed, and they kind of blamed us for it. So we were kind of gone like a year after. And so in retrospect, I would have still liked to have owned Lucky Brand, and probably whatever money they paid us, we would have made, and stayed more connected. So I think it was kind of a mistake to sell it.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, short term it was great and you got some money and all of that, mm-hmm. but there was nothing like having that, and seeing what, you know, what's kind of gone on with it is kind of painful in a way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the culture that we had was so incredible, and that's not what I hear. So that's kind of sad to see all these people wind up somewhere else, and it just, you know, the whole thing kind of crashed.
Well, it was bought by a very large corporation, and so that kind of tends to happen.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. It was, and they were good for a while, and the new people that bought it are really fantastic people.
So let's talk about Civilianaire for a minute. So you now have a new brand that you're involved with. So you want to tell us about that? And
yeah, it's everything's made in America. It's called Civilianaire, and you know, I love it, and I'm not sure that it's loving me back right now, you know, because I'm just funding it, trying to get it to work. We're building a customer base, people that like it, really get it, and, you know, we've got, you know, guys in their 20s and guys in their 70s, so, I mean, that's a pretty incredible thing to be able to pull that off. So I'm still funding it and trying to get it to work. You know, it's not happening quick enough. And I really think that you really have to be social media savvy these days. And I'm kind of a dinosaur there. So I'm trying all kinds of things, but I think it's really important.
We have a room full of students that are
good.
Social media savvy.
I'm into any help you guys can give me. We can barter if you think I've said anything that's could help you.
So with all you have going on, you must still be very busy. So we're curious what the day in the life of Gene Montesano looks like.
You know, it's pretty cool, you know. I mean, you know, when I drive to work, if I drive down that day, it's a 2.5-hour drive. That gets a little bit old, but I'm figuring out how to do that right. But it's mostly just creative stuff, and that's really great. But like I said, trying to get this thing to work and funding it is stressful. And I really haven't really had much stress in a long time. So it kind of gets to me a little bit. But I'm not a dweller, so I'm able to to see the things that work in it and try to focus on that. But it's cool. It's like it's styling, it's fabrics, it's colors, it's working with very creative people. So, you know, a day in the life is pretty good.
So I think we can open it up to questions. If anybody has any questions for Gene, start coming up to the mics, and I'll try to pay attention. So you have to get up if you have a question and line up at the mic. And then in the meantime, while you get situated, I have another question for you. So is there ever an end to your entrepreneurial journey when you start to relax more and do less?
Well, I couldn't ever imagine not doing what I do, and maybe I'll do it like this gelato thing. It doesn't take any of my time. So I think I can do more things like that where they don't take me my physical time, because, you know, I am getting older, and it's just I don't want to beat myself up as much as I have. So, but I've never stopped, you know, especially local stuff is much easier. But I could never stop being creative and having an idea and wanting to do it. I mean, I think that would be the end of me.
Go ahead.
Hi.
How you doing?
How and when did you know to sell Lucky? What was the factor that made you decide let's sell?
You know, I thought that we didn't really know how to take the next step. You know, we needed help in retail and operations and everything, and manufacturing in other countries, because it was starting to get bigger. So we didn't know we knew as much as we did. So we sold a part of the business to them, and they said we have 350 stores and just plug in, and we're sourcing in 21 countries, just plug in. So we sold the business and we plugged in, and it was a different frequency, so that didn't work. You know, we were sharing some of their field managers, and I'm standing in the store one day and I'm hearing her tell one of our customers, well, I don't know why you would do this. You could buy a pair of Levi's for $19.99. So I called the CEO and I said, guy, I mean, I'm plugging in. I got your people telling me why they don't understand. You could buy it for $19.99 and sourcing in other countries where they never made anything that they washed. We dye things, we wash things, we do so many things. So we had to go to these 22 countries and find the right factories or train the right factories to do it. That's why I said it was kind of a mistake. But we got to the point where we thought we needed help, and we thought that these guys could help us, and they did, and that they gave us some money. But they loved it, and they really tried. They wanted to help, but the help kind of was difficult.
Do you think it's a gut decision, though, deep down? Like, I'm 10 years into my business. I've had 3 offers to buy and have walked away from, like, end of the deal just because in my gut I knew it wasn't right.
Well, maybe later, if you want, we could chat about that for a second. Tell me what your business is and you know, if they're like-minded people, you know, you don't want to get into business with a shark or someone's going to steal your business from you. And, you know, so there's all kinds of people out there. So I think that would be a better Q&A kind of thing.
Thank you.
The great baseball manager, Leo DeRocha, once said, nice guys finish last. I have worked in the retail industry for 30 years, and I have found out that nice guys do not finish last, but they don't necessarily finish first. How do you describe nice guys in the business world, and how do they fit in?
It depends. I think it depends. I mean, I think I know lots of nice guys that have finished first. So they happen to be nice guys and have to be good at what they do. But I think being a nice guy definitely helps.
Helps.
I mean, it definitely helps. Whether you come in first or not, but, you know, first is, you know, it's like, you know, how many NFL teams you have. Only one guy wins the Super Bowl, but lots of people live off it and are happy playing. So, you know, I think being a nice guy is really, really, really important.
Thank you.
I don't know if that, you know.
No, that's a great answer.
Go ahead.
First, I want to thank you for all the great restaurants you brought to our area.
Thank you.
Awesome.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
You haven't spoken a lot about market research.
Yes, probably because I don't do any.
Well, that's, yeah, that's really interesting because it's a place that has sort of stopped me from doing something that I feel very strongly about, and I like what you said about you're in love with your idea.
Yeah, I mean, I've done like no market research on anything. You know, I just you know, listen. I think if you love something and you're not some crazy person and you like something and you believe it enough, chances are there's a whole bunch of people that feel the same way about it that you do. So, you know, I mean,
I love that.
I think, you know, have at it, unless it's some crazy idea. Just give it a shot.
I actually don't think it's a crazy idea at all, and I do love it. And the other question then is, like, often you hear, there's a sort of phrase now about mean and lean and start a lean start. I have a sense of starting bigger, of doing it as big as I possibly can. Do you have any sort of, what did you think when you were launching something? I'm going to kind of bootstrap it
Well, like I said, when I started Lucky Brand, I made a couple hundred pair of jeans and gave them out. So while I don't know what it is that you want to do, there's always a way to test it, you know? So, I mean, and if there's no market research on it, maybe you've discovered something that no one else has, you know? So I think have at it, but don't get yourself in trouble.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Well, when you say you gave your blue jeans away, that was your market research because everybody loved them. So you kept manufacturing more of what people wanted?
It would have been market research had I made them, gave away to see what people thought. That's not what I did. I gave them away and people came back and told me it was great, but that's where I was going. So, you know, it wasn't, or I would have made 5 different styles and given them away and said, get back to me and let me know. It was just, I made them, I thought they were great, and I was, you know what I mean? So
yeah.
It was, I guess it was market research, but.
Well, it turned into market research unintentionally.
Yeah, okay.
Obviously, you're a really busy person. You got restaurants, clothing. Any of us that have to get something started, we have to make a living. A lot of you guys are young, you don't have to deal with it yet, but you have families and kids. How do you juggle your time to get everything done that needs to be done? Working for a living, you know, 40 hours a week, and then you want to start up something. How do you juggle the priorities on what should be done and what needs to be done?
Well, you know, luckily things are going well mostly. And if there's not, then I've got some work to do, and I try to react real quick and get it corrected. So there's only X amount of hours in the day, and I sleep some. And I really only put out fires when there's fires. And you know, I have some pretty good people with me, so the fires we keep to a minimum. That's how you do it. There's only 24 hours in a day. So, you know, the restaurants are all kind of run themselves, and you know, if you get a bad egg, you gotta fire them, or if the food's no good, you need another chef. But you know, and I fly pretty low to the ground, but I'm really not hearing too many problems, and I've got good help. Johnny's fantastic, he helps me a lot, and I've got reports that I can just, you know, at night I can just take a look at what everybody did and read reports of what went wrong and what went right. And if there's something wrong, we get on it right away, and if there's not, I don't have much to do. It's really kind of as simple as that, for me, anyway.
So a lot of it is having good people that can do these things for you, or you can just do the higher level stuff.
Yeah, it's a combination. I think your idea's got to be good. You have to be crystal clear on what it is, give them the tools to do it, and people that care enough to do it, you know, and that don't have their own agenda. And I think it's that, the clearer you are, the clearer I am, I think the better it is for everybody. And I'm not saying I could do it on my own. I can't. But I think that you've got to be clear, and I'm pretty clear. I know what I want pretty quick. So as long as I'm getting it, I'm good.
I may be the only person in the room who doesn't know. What is Civilianaire?
Men's and women's clothing, very casual. Made in Los Angeles, You know, the range is pretty broad. It's basics. You could buy it today and wear it for 25 years, and if that's your style, you're never out of place, you know? So it's just really right down the middle.
I'm going to look for it. Thank
you.
Yeah,
check it out. It's a couple doors down from Tre Luna in Montecito.
Give us out some of that, and we'll wear it around for you.
What is that?
She asked you to give it away, and they'll wear it around for
you.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So I just have a couple more questions. One is, what are your thoughts on philanthropy? I know you started the Lucky Brand Foundation at some point, and what do you feel is important for entrepreneurs to know about giving back once they've made it?
You know, it's just karma. You know, you gotta help whenever you can. You know, and the Lucky Brand Foundation, we raised so much money for kids that, you know, Association for Children with Down Syndrome, Children's Hospital, cleft palate, and all kinds of things, rheumatoid arthritis. We built a camp with a pool in Philadelphia for these kids to have that. It's very rare, skin cancer where they can't be in daylight. So we built them a swimming pool and a camp. And it was really great stuff. It was really great that we did that. And I think, you know, like I said, you make your own luck, you know. So I think wherever you can help, you should help, you know. Anyway, it's not about tooting my horn or anything.
Approximately how many new ideas do you have floating in your head right now?
You know, kind of, you know, well, first of all, in our business, we have to have new ideas every day. So a lot of that. But other things that I'd like to, like little things I'd like to invent.
Like 10 new things that are floating in your head right now?
Like what?
10
I have one that I really want to work on.
But you can't tell us.
No, I really can't. Because it's probably like her idea, it's probably so simple. And I'm sure there's no market study done on it. But it helps you eat.
So I think you started to touch on this a little bit in the beginning, but I wanted maybe a little clarification. I think there's a lot of people who have great ideas, and I bet a lot of the entrepreneurial students have wonderful ideas, and there are also people who have access to a lot of funds now. But what is it that actually makes an entrepreneur successful with those elements? What do you think it is that sets you apart from people who have those good ideas and may even have the funding to back it up?
You know, I think I've been lucky, and I think I've been lucky enough to go into something when all the planets were aligned. I'm sure there are people much better at all the businesses that I'm in that haven't had the success. Either they weren't at the right place at the right time or what, but I mean, I don't know. I just think it's all got to kind of be aligned to make it work.
And if I can just follow up on that, a lot of us, you know, have to deal with the failures that come with business. And I know that's a personality trait, too. Some people can sort of just pick themselves up and move on. Do you attribute your personality and having to battle the downside of the market and failures in your market to just moving on? Or is there something else that you...
Oh, I've failed. You know, I've failed plenty.
How do you move on from those failures?
How do you pick
yourself up and keep going?
Well, you know what? I got to tell you, I have a whole lot of confidence in myself, and this is going to sound really cocky, but I'm not being cocky. I think when something doesn't work, it's not necessarily that it wasn't my idea that didn't work. I mean, I had Cafe Luck, which I thought was the greatest restaurant ever, and it failed, and it cost me a fortune. And, you know, I know the food was great, and the place was great. It just didn't work because I guess Santa Barbara just wasn't into it, but... So be it, you know. But you know, Babe Ruth was the home run king, but he struck out more than anybody else too, because he always swung the bat, you know.
So our final question better be a good one.
Oh, it's pretty good. It's pretty good. It's pretty good.
Pressure's on.
Okay. Well, I've noticed. I guess I've been following a lot of entrepreneurs and talking to them as much as I can, and most of them are saying that entrepreneurship is becoming more glorified and something that a lot of people want to go into because it's cool. Be your own business owner, boss, whatnot. About what time in your life did you realize that you're an entrepreneur and started to sway away towards entrepreneurship instead of going down the college path or school, like you were saying that you weren't really a student?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I didn't even know what an entrepreneur was until I was maybe 30 or something. But I don't know. I just always wanted to make stuff and just be in control of my own destiny if I could. And it started out small, like making a leather bag, and then that grew into all of this. And that's how it happens. And Les Wexner said, the founder of Limited Stores, if you by 26, if you haven't had everything you have on the come line, you're not an entrepreneur. So it's not that you want to be doing something. It's who you are, and it's not. Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think it's something you decide to be. Mm-hmm. You either are or you're not. You know. So I think that's kind of what it is.
Thank you.
So as we wrap up here, I want to know, do you have any parting advice for our new entrepreneurs?
You know, don't listen to the people that tell you, no, it can't be done. You know, and if they do tell you it can't be done, you have to look at it. But don't, when they just say no, just don't take it as no, because it can usually be done, and people tell you no for a lot of different reasons.
Thank you so much for coming and visiting us today.
For,
we really appreciate the time with you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. You know, the world belongs to those who show up. We see it here, and all of you showed up. And thank you so much for your participation. Thank you, Gene, and everybody, all of our supporters here. Let's go out and have some food and drink out in the lobby, and we'll enjoy.